Assalamu alaikum and welcome to Youth Matters, a show looking at local, global and national issues affecting young people. Now, on today's show, we are discussing the topic of domestic violence. Statistics show that one in four women and one in six men suffer from domestic violence at some stage in their life. Now, that is a staggeringly concerning statistic. What we want to discuss today is who really needs our help? Is it the victim who suffers the abuse? Is it the perpetrator who actually does the abusing? Or what about the children who are bystanders in this? Who needs our support? And I, as always, I want you to get involved at home, okay? Tell us, what is your opinion on this, okay? Why does it happen? Do you know people who have gone through this and experienced it in their life? What have they done about it? What have they not done? What should they be doing? Please get in touch and tell us what you think. If there are young people watching this, let us know what you think about domestic violence. Is enough being done about it? Are you receiving the education that's needed on this very sensitive topic? Or do you feel that not enough is done? So please do get in touch. We've got the number and the email that you can contact us and get involved with this show. Amra asku discuss kore on domestic violence. Domestic violence ekta mane koto jinish khabar kore. Amrar koto ase amra gora intor maze betainte maroin. Betinto ase situation of betainte maroin. Mawafe hurutainte maroin. Hurutaino aso inze mawafainte maroin. Koto situation ase. Ekta koto bad jinish, but oi. But oile amra kita koron. Amra mawafe kita koroin. Hurutainte e situation rufe taro iktar hota matoin ni khuloke bo ezudin khoshto fain zamair gestone bo e matrani khure khoirani zamaiyo akta akta amra community maze eta beshi mat khota hoy na khine betainte so shomoy matoin na but tebo to tara bitre bitre khoshto horna so okta rufe asko amra show horan apnara please shori koiba amra apnara gestone jantan sai apnara janon ni khu je domestic violence or gestone khoshto faison khoshto faira kita khorra khaloge matra please apnara amra ra guroka as always this is your show and we want you to get involved on this very important topic. I'll start with you, Leila. Welcome to the show.
Thank you very much.
Okay, now Leila, just to kind of set the scene so that people at home know what we're discussing. When we talk about domestic violence, what does domestic violence cover? And how would you define domestic violence?
See, domestic violence, people know it as, if you're going to ask someone what is domestic violence, they're going to automatically assume that it's only to do with a female that is suffering from violence at home by a husband or by a spouse, by a partner. But it's a lot more than that. As you rightly said, it's men suffer from domestic violence as well. And domestic violence, it's not just physical violence. You're talking about sexual violence, financial, financial as well. You're talking about different traumas, mental health.
Sure.
So there's a lot of abuse, financial abuse, psychological abuse. That's the biggest one. Mm. And that's a big key issue with victims of domestic violence.
Now, Naila, welcome on the show.
Thank you for having us.
That's fine. Naila, in terms of, we spoke about obviously different types of abuse. Would you say verbal abuse
abuse and emotional abuse. A lot of women that we come across, their families or their partners put them down often and they don't give them confidence and they're quite broken that way, and that has a big effect on them, the way that you're treated. If you're in an aggressive atmosphere all the time, you haven't got a chance to be yourself or relax at home, then that's quite harmful to a family.
Okay, that's really interesting. Julie, thank you for coming on the show.
Thank you for having me.
Tell us about the different relationships in which domestic violence arises.
It's not just, as we said before, women being abused by men, as well as men being abused by their wives. It could also be parental abuse, either the child can be abusing the parent, or the parent can be abusing the child. It could be in-laws. Sometimes we've actually had to deal with that quite a few times as well. It could be the child. There's even distant relatives sometimes can be involved in part of the abuse as well. It's actually quite around.
Okay, because I think the common kind of misconception is that it's just when a husband abuses the wife, yeah, or the wife abuses the husband. So mm-hmm. there's actually so many different, yeah, different types of relationships that could arise in this. Leila, going back to you, what would you, you spoke about financial reasons. Please elaborate on that a bit more for us. What do you mean by financial reasons?
Sure, I mean, it could be, I mean, Julie's probably the best person that can go into detail in this, but it's more of a case of if you're in a relationship and you do have a partner that is, or just say, for example, the victim is someone that's earning, you know, quite a bit, or they do have a steady income, and you have your partner that would be, you know, mentally abusing you, making you feel that you need to, like, your money is not yours, that you need to continuously, you know, give. And when you're giving, you'll find that, you know, these victims tend to lose a lot more money, and what they're doing is, you know, giving away everything that they've got just to feed. When I'm saying feeding, I'm not talking about food, but I'm talking about vices, different vices. Just say the partner's a, you know, a gambler,
sure,
and you're giving everything to them, to, you know, to feed their habits. And by financial abuse, this is when, you know, someone's going to be more put, be put more and more in debt and drained of their finances.
Wow. Okay. Now, obviously, it's a very difficult subject to talk about, Naila. Which ethnic group would you say domestic violence is most prominent in?
I would say that domestic violence is quite prominent amongst all ethnic groups. It's not typically one culture or one religion or one background. But if you look across all domestic situations, I'm sure the statistics can back that up.
Sure.
And also on Layla's point, what she was saying about financial abuse, there's been women that we've come across who haven't had access to their own bank accounts. When they wanted to leave their situations, they haven't known their national insurance number, they haven't known their income, anything about what's going on in the household. And for someone in that situation, it's a form of control. The other person can't leave, they find it hard to leave or hard to get help or do anything by themselves because they're belittled and told they don't know how to and they haven't got access to their
documents. So am I right in understanding that what you're saying is that in some cases the abuser will take away, even though the person is earning the money, they would have no control over their money?
Yeah, in some situations that can occur. It was, the abuser will take away their bank account. If a new card comes to the house, for example, they'll make sure they get the post before them and they'll make sure they have no access to any way to get out from the situation or any help.
Okay, now, Julie, why would someone do something like that? Because obviously, you know, when we talk about relationship, it's about we associate it with love and care. And why would someone want so much control? That's what I'm getting here.
That's actually the main part of all domestic abuse relationships is about power and control. It all, every part of it revolves around those two words, power and control. The financial part is to stop them from either leaving or being to make choices. Basically, the victim's choices are taken away from them in every aspect. So it's quite there's a lot more to talk about, really.
Sure. But okay, that's fine. Now, what would you say, Julie, are the common traits in an abuser? Because if, you know, we've got people watching at home, you know, watching nationally, internationally, What are the traits?
It's not actually as simple as that, because quite often an abuser can come across as very charming, very articulate. They can often be loved by their family and their friends and everything like that, because what happens on the inside.
So it could be people that we least expect to be.
Yes.
Okay, is that a lot of the times, is that the case?
Very few violent perpetrators actually are violent outside as well, so everybody can see them.
Okay.
The majority of them do it behind closed doors.
Okay.
So it's very hard for other people to see it.
So what kind of, I guess, you know, personality traits, what kind of traits do they have when we speak about, you know, that then evolves into them committing such an act? So what is it that would make someone abuse someone else in a relationship?
A lot of abusers actually don't, although they might come across that they have self-love, they don't. It's where they have, a lot of them don't have, know how to deal with emotions and all that sort of thing.
What would you say, Leila? Would you say there's other, you know, what other reasons could result in a person committing such acts?
Well, you know, you'll always hear about cases where there'll be like just a domestic argument, you know, couples that will be arguing. And you know, some say that, you know, either the female, you know, in the group would kind of push them to a limit and they'll lash out. But in most cases, like the severe cases, sure, of domestic violence, there is really no reason. It was just in a lot of the cases we found that it's just one man's insecurity or one woman's insecurity, where they're themselves, they will have like a trust issue, or they'll have like you know, their own personal issues. You know, we've come across brothers that have tried to get help for their own anger, and you'd find out that when you look into their history, you know, they too had suffered some form of abuse, whether it was physical abuse, being hit by a parent growing up. And when they've been into a relationship, you know, there is no reason for it. Sure, you know, they just tend to lash out on the ones that they supposedly love the most. But there is real...
Is there a correlation between people who are abused or experience abuse at a young age and who become abusers when they grow up?
There, I have seen statistics, sure, and I have seen research to say that, you know, children that are abused tend to grow up and be either abusers themselves. I mean, there was an article that I read not so long ago when it was looking into paedophilia, and it was said that some of the perpetrators had actually been abused or suffered some abuse themselves in childhood. Yeah. But then in many cases as well, you'll find that is not the case for a lot of them. There is some sort of psychological aspect to it, but in some cases, in most cases, like I said before, it's just one person's insecurities or one person's issues that they have with themselves that they tend to feel the need to overpower someone else and enforce their, you know, whether it's their masculinity or whether they want to make a point or put a point across to show they're the most powerful thing. It is a control thing.
Naila, I wanted to ask you, would you say that it is more that perpetrators, because of the stigma attached, people who are men who go through abuse tend not to talk about it as much?
I think definitely with men in general, we see that the suicide rate is higher in males because males, they tend to not talk to people as much about their emotions and the way they're feeling, and they can feel like less masculine if they talk to people. And they say, we all have that joke, oh, you'd be beaten up by a woman, and you know, they don't want to hear that. And it takes quite a lot for them to go out and seek help, and they may often not be believed. And the other thing I want to touch on is what you were talking to Leila about anger management. The difference between a domestic violence and someone with an anger issue is someone with an anger issue will be angry, will easily lose their temper at everyone, at the bus driver, at the shopkeeper, they might easily lose their temper. But someone who's a perpetrator of domestic violence, they lose their temper at a specific person for a specific purpose. Sure. So it's different from a general anger management issue.
So we're talking about, you know, anger being one of the kind of personality traits. What other traits is there in a person who's an abuser?
Well, someone that is definitely controlling, who wants control over their environment and everyone in it. And I also think it's someone who's quite entitled. They've got a sense of entitlement, like everything should be done for me, everyone should listen to me. And they don't have empathy for other people's feelings and emotions. I think those are the traits. But like Julie said, often with these perpetrators, if you meet them, they will be the most charming people. You will never believe that what goes on behind closed doors. And that's also a way of isolating the victim. Because when the victim comes forward, people will say, how can it be that man? We don't believe you. He's like this. We all know how good he is, how great he is. He plays with our children. He's very charming. He's very nice. And no one, it makes it hard for people to believe them.
Sure. And Julie, which age group would you say this is most, you know, domestic abuse and violence is most prominent amongst?
It goes through all ranges, but just recently there's been statistics that have shown actually that it's probably between the age, I think it's 16 and 24, that have been the highest rates of domestic abuse, which actually is quite horrifying really, because a lot of them, it shows that a lot of our children are not being taught what a healthy relationship is from an early age. Because a lot of the abuse is even happening in school. It starts in school and gangs and all sorts, you know. So we need to, from an early age, start teaching our children.
Primary education, that seems to be a key factor in this. Okay, Leila, would you say, are people of particular profile more prone to being victims? For example, you know, say divorced men or divorced women. Would you say there are certain profiles of people?
I wouldn't particularly say there's a certain profile, because it can happen to anyone. I mean, you know, you've got the strongest sister sitting here that I know, who, you know, she'll tell you herself, you know, about her background, but she's the strongest woman that I know, one of the strongest, mashallah. And, you know, she herself was a victim. And then you do have other women that are a lot more quiet, you know, in some cases, well, in quite a few of the cases, you'll find that sisters that are from abroad, so that have come over here, you know, they don't speak a lot of English, you know, it's a bit slow for them to integrate, you know, into society, so they're a lot of the time they're staying at home. They tend to be victims as well.
Okay.
But then again, it can be anyone.
Sure.
There's not a set, you know, profile.
Yeah, sure. Nyla, I guess what I'm trying to allude to is the fact that, you know, we've spoken about how the abusers, they like control, and they want to have that advantage over the other person.
Yeah.
And so when you look at certain profiles, Leila's spoken about, you know, women who come from, you know, other countries, and they might not understand the language, the culture, so they're an easy target. So I guess, you know, are there certain people, you know, like divorced women who might be targeted as well because of, you know, in some communities it's seen as a weakness?
I don't think that it can be easy for people within like an Asian background to target divorced women, also Muslims to target reverts, people that don't have the support of their family around them to back them up. That is easy, but it has to be said that anyone can suffer from domestic abuse. It can be, you can be a teacher, a lawyer, you can be a professional and suffer from domestic abuse. And sometimes part of the abuse is to keep the person isolated. So when people come from abroad, and some people come from abroad and they're told to go out, mix, and they're helped to do that. Other people come from abroad and they're told, no, you can't go to English classes. With divorced women, they're often told, your friends are not good for you, don't see them. So it's a way of, people that can be easily isolated would be victims.
Okay.
Sometimes.
Viewers, once again, you know, this is your show. We want you to get involved. We want you to tell us, you know, what do you think about some of the conversations that we're having in this studio? What are your experiences of domestic violence? What have you seen? What have you heard? You know, we want to hear from you, our young viewers at home. You know, how has domestic violence affected you? What kind of impact has it had on your life? Have you seen it? Have you heard about it? Please get in touch. You've got the number and the email on the screen. Julie, coming back to you, would you say, you know, alcohol you hear about the ill effects of alcohol, obviously, that it has on a person. How big of a part does alcohol consumption have and the link to domestic violence?
This is something that I've covered quite a lot in the groups that I've run.
Sure.
Alcohol, drugs, all those things, they're not actually a reason for domestic abuse at all. They might bring it forward faster, or, you know, there might be shorter times between each bout of violence because of the alcohol. Mm. But the person who is perpetrating this is already that type of person. The alcohol and drugs actually has nothing to do with why they are abusing somebody.
Okay, so that's quite interesting. So say, for example, if someone, you're saying there's no correlation as such between you know, alcohol or substance misuse, mm-hmm. and that leading to someone or pushing them over the edge, it doesn't.
There is because there are many people that are abusers and they don't actually touch any of it. So in fact, the majority of abusers don't have alcohol problems or drug problems or anything like that. The actual the amount of people that do is a smaller amount. So that actually statistically shows that that's not a reason for it.
Okay. Leila, what are the short-term and long-term effects on children who are in the middle of, you know, domestic issues?
There's never going to be a short-term effect. It will be something that will always be a long-term effect. If you have a child that is being brought up, you know, in what's supposed to be a loving and safe environment, seeing, you know, their parents either, you know, bickering or fighting, getting physical, that will always be at the back of their minds. Now, in some of the cases that, well, in the different cases that we've come across in working with sisters and with some brothers, you'll find that, you know, some young boys will either grow up to be very overprotective over their sisters, over their wives, you know, and they'll become the most loving gentlemen ever only because they don't want to, you know, replicate what they've seen. But then again, you will have some children that will grow up to have anxiety issues, that will have depression, that will have you know, problems with their sleep, like insomnia. You'll have children that will wet the bed. You'll have, you know, various different things, and it will all be linked to what they've experienced or what they've witnessed. So it will never be a short term, you know, effect on them. It will always be long term. It will always be something that, you know, they will think of, especially if it's a violent, you know, if they've seen their parents become violent with each other.
Okay, thank you. That's the end of this segment. Please do stay with us, because in the next segment we will have Julie talking about her personal experiences with domestic violence, and we will also have perspectives from young people telling us what they think. Now, this is an English show, and I know we're getting a lot of phone calls, people asking for us to speak in Bengali. Now, our guests aren't always able to speak Bengali, and that's why it's quite difficult. Telephone করে আখুইরা আপনারা সাইরে একটা আমরা বাঙালি মাতি তা আমরা গেস্টাইনতে বাঙালি মাতা ফারুইন না সো আমরা কি দাহর মু নেক্সট সেগমেন্ট আমরা যতখান ফারি বাংলায় মাতমো আমি আপনারা যতখান বুঝাই দাম ফারি বুঝাইমু ইনশাআল্লাহ আর আপনারা কত মানছে খুইরা টেলিফোন করে আখুইরা কত হরিণ আসেন হরিণতে বয়ন্ত লগে জেলা বাদ ব্যবহার করেন একটা ডোমেস্টিক ভায়োলেন্স নিয়ে অ্যাবিউস নিয়ে জয় আমরা এক্সপার্ট হইতে খুঁজ হইন হরিণতে না হরাইনতে যদি নানি বয়ন্ত লগে বাদ ব্যবহার করেন একটু অবাদ এখানে যে জিনিসে একজনের মাথার মাঝে না দিলর মাঝে দুঃখ দেয় আর একটার দায় থারা বাদে নানি আর কষ্ট পায়ন একটু হইল অ্যাবিউস সো আপনি যদি হরিতা হইন নাই আপনি মা তা হইন নাই আপনি বোন নাই ভাই আপনি যদি খেউরে কষ্ট দেন জেলা তারা অত বাদ লাগে ভিতরে তারা গিয়া তারা নিজের জান নেন কি আমরা খুঁজছি সব সাইড বইনাইন্তর মাঝে একজনে তারা লাইফের মাঝে একটা কষ্ট পায়ন সো আমরা কত জানা সইন আমরা কমিউনিটির মাঝে বই নাইন বাই আইনতে কষ্ট পাইরা সো প্লিজ আপনারা যদি হরেন তা হইনি তা হরেন তে একটু আপনারাও নানি চিন্তা করিয়া দেখো একটা কত কষ্ট দিরা ওকে সো দ্যাটস দি এন্ড অফ দিস সেগমেন্ট প্লিজ ডু স্টে উইথ আস আসসালামু আলাইকুম Assalamu alaikum and welcome back to Youth Matters, where we're discussing the topic of domestic violence. Domestic violence, as we've said, it affects many people. One in four women experience domestic violence in their lifetime, and one in six men experience domestic violence in their lifetime. It's a staggeringly concerning statistic that we're discussing. We're trying to find out, you know, why does it happen? What can we do? And what kind of support can we give? As we discussed, তান বৌয়ে জামাই লগে বাদ ব্যবহার হরইন মায়ের দর হরইন একটা মানে বাদ জিনিস বা খেনে হরয় একটা যেবলা থান থান হরইন তোর বার হরইন হুরু তাইনতে যে দেখরা থারার কিলা লাগে থারা কোন কষ্ট ফাইন তারা যেগুলা বড়ইন একটা থারার কিলা এফেক্ট হরে সো প্লিজ আপনারা আমরা লগে শরিক হোক আপনারা ঠেলিমো হোক বাঙালিয়ে ঠেলিমো হরিয়া কোয়েশ্চেন জিকাও কেনা ইংলিশে জিকাও আমরা দুটা আনসার হরমো বা প্লিজ গোরাও কা also amnara email korte chaile email o korte parba. Please, this show is all about, you know, we want you to get involved and tell us what you think. You know, the discussions that we're having here, you know, what, how does that make you feel? What is your opinion? We want to know. So please do get in touch. Now, in this segment, I'd like to welcome Amin, familiar face. Okay. Thanks for coming on the show, Amin.
Thanks.
Amin, from, I guess, from your experience, have you heard of cases of domestic violence, abuse amongst friends, relatives, that you can share with us without obviously mentioning names?
Yeah, of course. I mean, of course, I've never been a recipient of it, and neither have people in my family. However, I have heard of cases, being a medical student, and I'm currently on my psychiatry placement.
Okay.
I've met patients that have been victims of it, and it's led to a decrease in their psychological state. And domestic violence is a big reason to why people have poor states, why they're low mood, what was discussed in the last segment about depression and how it leads to many things. So it's not something unfamiliar to me. In fact, you can speak to any medical student, any doctor, and it's a bread and butter case that they might run into during their practice.
Sure. Now, Tasnim, tumi tumar life maze la experience khorson ya so inni tumar kutuma intor maze na friend intor maze sela taro la domestic violence or man experience ase.
Yeah. So growing up, I've seen quite a few cases. Again, like Amin, I myself have not been a recipient of it.
Okay.
But I know people that have been. I know, for example, a mother, a wife, who, as under the hands of her husband, who's had a psychiatric illness, she herself had to deal with it for a number of years. And obviously they had three young children, and that's had a huge impact on the children, the wife. The man himself had to be put on a restraining order. And like many things happen, and it's really sad, because I know these people myself, and I've been able to see firsthand the kind of effects that it has on a person. So, for example, the father, who was once upon a time a hero to his son, he was 10 years old when all of these things happened. So now, as you could say, like a young adult, you can see the effects that it's had on him.
True.
And you know, it is really, really sad to see. And because the thing is, what it is that these are children that have had a very kind of difficult experience, and now they're kind of having to, as adults, having to, you know, undo the damage that was done to them, which is really hard to do. Whereas if you've had a good, healthy upbringing, you grow up to be quite wholesome kinds of people. Whereas if you've had that experience as a child, you grow up not whole, and it really affects the relationships that you have in the future. It really affects your self-esteem. It really affects how you view the world. And
sure,
to undo that is just so hard.
Mm. Now, Julie, thank you for agreeing to talk about some of the personal experiences you've had. We appreciate that, because I think it provides that kind of real experience of what women in our community and on a wider scale are going through on a day-to-day basis. Now, tell us about your experiences.
I was physically, sexually, emotionally, psychologically and financially abused by my ex-husband. On many occasions, I was hit with objects. In fact, on one occasion, I was hit with a hammer. Missed my kneecap by about half an inch. I have scars on my head from having things broken on my head. I was strangled and just let go just before I passed out, pulled by my hair, forced to do degrading sexual things. I couldn't say no. If I said no, he would rape me and take it anyway, because he saw it as his right as a husband. Financially, going back to something that was said in the beginning, when Layla said financially, I was the one that was bringing the money into the home. I paid the bills, I paid the rent, I bought the food, I paid for my son's childcare, I paid everything. And then when everything was paid, there was no money left. So when I wanted to leave, I had no money to leave. In fact, I got myself in debt to leave, because I had to get an overdraft to be able to leave. And when I did finally leave, because I left him in my home, he actually ran up more debts in my name. And I didn't find out until probably 6 months to a year later, when the bailiffs were coming for me. Emotionally, there was name calling, being told I wasn't a good parent. Psychological, I mean, I was timed how long it would take me to go to the shop, timed how long it took me to take my son to school. I used to have to get up at 5 o'clock in the morning to do my housework because then I wasn't able to see anybody out of my windows, because if I looked at somebody out the windows, I was accused of looking at them in a way that, you know. There's so much more, and that's just the put in a small section of what I went through.
Sure, I know it's very difficult to kind of recall some of those memories. What type of abuse would you say started first?
The psychological.
If you want to give some examples, people at home can relate.
It was silly little things. Phoning me from home at home when he was at work, because at first I wasn't working. Then he decided I needed to work. But he would phone. It was a couple of times a day. It was, oh, you're always on my mind. I had to speak to you. Then it was every half an hour. If he didn't come to the phone quick enough, where are you? Weren't you on the phone?
So it was quite, I'd say, quite kind of loving and caring to start off with. Because if someone does that, you think they're actually thinking about
me. Oh, that's so nice. Yeah. He can't get me off his mind. You know, those subtle little things. You go to the shop, so you took a long time. You know, all those. And then you started questioning, was that a long time? You know. And moving things in my home to the point I thought I was going mad. I was like, have you seen so-and-so? Yeah, it's over there. But I never put it over there.
Psychological.
Yeah. He moved my TV so that I couldn't look out the window. But he said it was so that it was no glare from the window. It's all sure. Little things like that, yeah.
Sure. I'll come back to you, Julie. Samra Boine. Boyne khuira tan experience or khota khuira tan zamai loge agor zamai loge asla tan zamai tan re bot khoshto disoin tan re mar soin tan re khota ta khoi soin gan lei soin tan re khota ta jin shtain sai soin nakhorta tan zure khora ya loi soin tan re ze foisha tain ruzi khor soin o foisho ni soin nia tan re mani kuchu disoin na zela tain tan gestone zaita fartana horia. So then we were then many cub khoshto lakse atan re ek bar aturadi mariar sla ita marsun atura tan vaidi television jinish koror maze horai soen horai ya koi ba bade tan je bala goroi soen khoi soen tumi o ekta to ono horani hoyse tumi jancho nani tan mani mind reloya mani satai soen sataiya o ola aromboise foila telefon khor bagoro goro khori ya koi ba tumi khoi tumara ami bot bakad bilonaze matsina mattan saira. So foila dekhai soin mane khub maya fer khub mane maya khorra ar bade aste aste dekha geche tan nani ashole tan aro niyot ase ar bade mai reise ar mar soin. So apnara je dekhra o apne bangal english o matte parle na apnara please guri amra hok apnara eta dekhra ni amra community maze eta onni because amra eta kotha matina par apni chinta koriya dekho ke ekjone jodi eta goro maze khoshto kore te tara ek ki jati life ar tara matra nakhine. So please, apnara naam kuchu khwalak na, apnara guroka, guriya khu kamra, dekhoinni, illa onni. Please, you know, we're talking about, we're sharing experiences of Julie's personal circumstances. And, you know, it's very difficult to listen to these. But I want you to get involved. I want you to tell us what are your personal experiences. And if it's, you know, it might not be yourself, it might be your neighbor or your relatives. You know, tell us, what did they go through? What did they do? How are they now? So that it gives us all hope and gives us courage to those who are watching at home, that they don't have to suffer alone and in silence. Now, I mean, how does that, just listening to the personal stories of Julie, how does that make you feel?
It's just tragic, it's heartbreaking, really. I mean, you'd think to yourself, how can a human being do that? Mm. I can't speak for Julie's experience, and I don't know what her husband is like, but was there some sort of, you know, you want to look for a reason to justify or see how they could act that way, but it's difficult when you've done something that grievous, that nasty over a long period of time. Mm. It's hard to find excuses for that kind of person, and it's something that nowadays in our society, it's, you know, it's prevalent. It's more and more oftenly seen. You know, you even see glimpses in school with bullying and things like that. It's just a minor form of psychological torture, you know, we've seen reports and we've heard stories of students that have actually committed suicide because of the amount of bullying that's that they've been enduring. Mm. And this is really what it leads to.
Sure. Tasnim, why would young people, why do you think young people don't talk about their experiences of witnessing domestic violence?
I think it's sometimes it's just to do with the fact that they actually don't know that it's something that they should talk about. And I think often people feel like it's something that they almost can't talk about. And it's very, generally when you're in that kind of situation, you feel as though you can't trust people or you feel as though you're not going to be heard. So that's why I really respect Sister Julie here for actually coming here and speaking about it and actually being actively trying to raise awareness, because that's a really, really hard thing to do. Mm. Like, because the thing is, when you're in that situation, it really hardwires your mind into thinking that what you went through was almost acceptable, because that's kind of the reason why you almost allow yourself to be in that situation for such a long period of time. And as you know, as we heard from her story, it's something that happened gradually. Mm. So she kind of, you know, kind of accepted it for such a long period of time until she realized, no, wait, I have to get out of this. And I think often it's just because of that, like they just don't actually know that they need to speak about it.
Sure. Now, Julie, coming back to you, how long did this last? And also, why didn't you do something earlier?
It was from 1999 to 2002, I think it was.
So 3 years.
There was always promises of change. I won't do it again. Or it got to a point where I questioned myself a lot. Was it my fault? Did I cause this? Because quite a lot of the psychological abuse was that. It was, if you hadn't have done that, I wouldn't have done this.
And that was so quite a justification.
And that's actually something that a lot of victims will say that they get, that they're often blamed for it. And so you get to a point where you believe that. You believe that it's something, you believe you are the one that has to change. If you don't change, it's not going to change. And that, so, I mean, it took me over 10, I think I left about 10 times and returned. And I left finally when I was pregnant with my youngest.
So you left when you were pregnant?
Yeah. But I also had a 9-year-old at the time when I left as well. So.
Can I ask you, how did it feel carrying the child of your abuser, knowing that what you obviously you had planned to leave it?
Yeah, it's not easy to go through, but from the beginning I made sure to tell myself that the child never chose her father. She never chose her father. She never chose to be here. So all I could do was love and nurture her as much as I could.
Sure. Before I translate what Sister Julia said, we're going to show a video very soon about this. I don't know if it's ready. Okay, so it'll get ready while I'm translating. So, আমরা বইনে খোয়াতাসলা তাইন তানে জিকানি হইছিল কতদিন ধরে একটা মানে experience for so in tain hoiso in 3 bochhorer tai 3 bochhorer period er majhe tai nita experience for so in but is kai sitan tai khol age kichu kholla na khine so eto tain khoiso in tain ze bla khorta sai so in tan jamai khoiso in na ek tumi sinda khoriyo na o tumi ota khors lai khori ami al lagin ota khorsi sob shomoy mane ekta reason asil mane tan dosh tain doiloka tain jodi nani telephone khane khorsen ami tumar da sinta khorat aslan gal leile tumi asko amare ki ban randia diso randa bala asin na lagin amar mon bala asin na lagin tumare gal leise so sob shomoy mane ekta excuse asil excuse khene tain bad bebar khorsen so el lagin tain amra boine mone one khoison o te thik ase tain jekta khoi ekta to rong khoi rana thik khoi ra amaro ki ban dosh asil so boine khoi ra ইতা যে মানছি তা করে আর খালি বেঠাইন আর খালি বেঠাইনতেই তা করেন না বেঠিনও আসবেন যে বেঠাইন তো লোকে বাদ ব্যবহার করেন তারা এমন রিজন দেন যেলা আপনি আপনার নিজরে বুঝাই দিলে বুঝি লাইবা দ্যাট ও আসলে আমার কি বান দোষ আছিল এর লাগিন না নি তাই বাদ ব্যবহার করছেন বাট আসলে একটা ঠিক নাই ওকে can we see the video? Okay. So, I mean, if I come back to you on this, do you think enough is being done to educate our young people about domestic abuse and domestic violence?
Definitely not. It's a taboo subject. It's something that, you know, children growing up in that environment, you know, I personally know stories as well of people that have grown up in that environment, and for them it's very much, you know, do as you're told, don't say anything. Yeah, this is happening, but this is behind closed doors. So they feel that it's a, you know, it can get to a point where it feels like a natural part of life. And it's obviously scars them mentally in the future. And, you know, there are conditions such as PTSD, post-traumatic stress disorder, where students can, or younger people when they grow older, after experiencing so much psychological trauma at a young age, they end up getting flashbacks and thinking about what's happened, and it leaves an imprint in their mind, and it will affect their future relationships. When they get married, my dad acted in this way, or somebody I know acted in that way. Should I act in that way? Is that normal? So it needs to be addressed, it needs to be educated, definitely.
Tasnim, children, you often hear that children tend to blame themselves.
Yeah.
So if, you know, and Julie was alluding to the fact that, you know, sometimes the justifications that were given, it was almost as though, you know, if you didn't do this, I wouldn't have done that. Do you think children sometimes don't talk about it because they feel as though they might have been the problem?
Yeah, I do think that because what happens is when they're subject to this abuse, or when they see, for example, their mother being abused, because they're not able to do anything about it, they feel like they kind of think that it's their fault, that because they weren't able to stop it. And when they see their mother suffering, and when they see that their siblings suffering, themselves suffering, you know, yeah, they will feel like that. And obviously there's this whole aspect of the self-fulfilling prophecy. If the abuser's always shouting these things at them, saying these things to them, you know, that's the way that they kind of accept this abuse. They accept that this is who they are. And, you know, much to Julie's experience as well, you have this, you have either Stockholm syndrome or battered wife syndrome, where you kind of empathize as well with the abuser.
Sure. Okay, thank you. We're just going to watch a short video about domestic abuse. It should come on your screen now.
I am a mother.
A father.
Son.
Daughter.
Brother.
A sister.
I am a student.
A stay-at-home mom.
Construction worker.
Volunteer.
I am loving.
Smart. Funny.
Generous.
Way too generous.
I am all of the amazing things you see.
But there's something you can't see.
Or don't see.
Something that I don't let anybody see.
Like when I'm alone.
In a room full of people.
I can't get out of bed.
And maybe I've gained weight.
Or lost weight.
Why do men always lose weight?
It can get dark in here.
Really dark.
Addicted to food.
The web.
Work.
Sex.
Alcohol.
Something to take the pain away.
To feel happy.
To feel something.
Anything.
Nothing.
Because depression isn't a mood.
It's not a passing thing.
Or a bad day.
It's a disease.
I can't just get over it.
It feels like I'm underwater.
Drowning.
And sometimes I think you'd be better off without me.
I am telling you this, all of this,
because I need help.
And you are my wife.
My dad.
My husband.
My kids.
My boss.
So please, don't judge me.
Leave me.
Fire me.
Please, be patient.
Don't give up on me.
Just be there for as long as it takes.
Just because you can't see it, doesn't mean it isn't real.
Okay, so that was a video just talking about the emotional feelings that people go through when they experience domestic violence and how it makes them feel. Julie, coming back to you now, when you were going through your experiences, who else knew about the abuse? Did you share it with friends, family members?
Not straight away. I did eventually. And most people said, just leave. but nobody would understand, was willing or ready to understand everything else that I was going through emotionally. And they never understood each time I went back either. And even now, to this day, most of them don't understand what I went through.
Okay. Now, thank you, Julie. What we will do is when we come back, we will listen to Julie and her experiences and try and understand. And I think what's really important is, you know, we want you to get involved. You know, we want to know what you've, how does it make you feel watching this? What are your experiences? Because, you know, this is something, and the title is, you know, we're trying to break the silence of domestic violence because not enough people are talking about it. The fact that Amin was speaking about that in schools, you know, and through his educational life and he's at university, you know, not enough is done to make children aware of it. So please, you know, help us in this fight against, you know, silence of domestic violence. And please get in touch and speak to us. Afnara, please go to Shorikoka. Afnara, tell me what you're Afnara, what are যেটা হুন্দ্রা একটা আপনার খিলা লাগে আমার বইনে হইরা তাইন ফইলা খেউরে হইছেন না বাদে আস্তে আস্তে তান কুটমাইন্তরে হইছেন ফ্রেন্ডান্তরে হইছেন তারা হইছেন সারিয়া যাওয়া গিজা মাইরে বাতাইন তাইন সব সময় বুঝছেন না খালি সারিয়া তো যাওয়া যায় না হরু তাইন আসছেন আরো কতটা আছে চিন্তা করা লাগে সো আপনারা প্লিজ থাকবো আমরা লগে ব্রেক বাদে আমরা আরো মাতমো আমরা বইন লাগে সালামু আলাইকুম Assalamu alaikum and welcome back to the final segment of Youth Matters, where we're discussing domestic violence and the impact it has on individuals and families and the wider community as a whole. Joining us again is Leila and Naila. Thank you for coming back. Julie, if we could carry on from where we left off, where we were speaking about you know, your personal experiences, please tell us, how were your children affected?
My son, before it all started, because he was from a previous relationship, he was lively, he made friends very easily, he was very bright, he had bright blue eyes, and that. But during the abuse, he just started to become silent. He didn't smile. In fact, I don't remember him smiling until we left. His eyes sort of dulled over. He actually were sunken in. He looked depressed. And I found out later on that that's how he felt, actually. And he still feels guilty. He's now 23. He feels guilty because he couldn't protect me. He carries that on his shoulders still. Wow. To this day. My daughter, as I said, I left when I was pregnant. It had an effect on my pregnancy. She was only 4'14" in weight. She was very small. I was told that she should have been about 7 pounds.
Sure.
My placenta had stopped growing, and they only found it out literally just before I had her.
Thank you, Julie. We've got a caller on the line. Assalamu alaikum, caller.
Wa alaikum assalam.
Boina, afna question kita.
I don't really have a question, sure. But I'd just like to say the sister who is speaking and who is sharing her experience with us, I can relate to the same sort of experience, and it's very familiar to what I went through as well.
Sure, sister. And how did you deal with it, sister?
I had support from my parents. I had my family supporting me, and just mentally, I was just so drained out. You know, it really got me thinking that I was at fault, that there was something wrong with me, and he would use my faith. He would use it against me, saying I was a bad wife, and, you know, if I didn't do as he said, I would go to hell, and... Even financially as well. I was dependent on my parents. When I was still married to him, my parents would buy me everything for my son and for myself. He was not very supportive in any sort of way, really.
Sister, are you still with your partner?
No, I left him 4 years ago, actually. On the 21st, it will be 4 years.
And how do you feel about that now, looking back? Do you feel?
Oh, I feel so grateful. I wouldn't have left him. My parents, they brought me back to their home, and I've been living with them since. And since that time away from him, it really, at first I was depressed. I still am depressed sometimes when I think about it. I don't know if, you know, that feeling's ever going to go away. But
thank you, sister, for sharing.
I just, you know, the damage that he's done, it's never going to go away. Even if it does, it's not going to go away so easily. With the community, it's why even today I'm still blamed. Even when they don't know the whole story, I'm still blamed. I'm shunned away.
Sure. Thank you, sister, for sharing your experience. May Allah make it easy. And inshallah, you know, we need sisters like the caller to come and talk about their experiences, to say, you know, this is how it was, but alhamdulillah, this is what I did. And I think she spoke, alluded to the fact that her family played a very big part. Mm-hmm. We're gonna watch a short video and then we'll come back to our guests.
No more, it's none of my business.
No more, I'm sure they'll work it out.
No more, boys will be boys.
No more, I'll say something next time.
No more, why didn't she tell anyone?
No more, she was flirting with him.
No more, she's too smart to let that happen.
No more, not my problem.
No more, he didn't mean it.
No more, why doesn't she just leave?
No more, he said he was sorry.
No more, she was drunk.
No more, she was asking for it.
No more, she seems just fine to me.
No more, she should have been more careful.
No more, we don't talk about that.
No more bystanding.
No more ignorance.
No more excuses.
No more.
No more.
No more.
So that was a video of celebrities showing their support for domestic violence and the fact that we have to all, you know, fight together to try and overcome this challenge. Going back to you, Laila, we obviously spoke about Layla. We spoke about, you know, the sister spoke about the family and how big of a role they played. What kind of, you know, friends in need, and, you know, what kind of, from your experience, who are the people that actually have an impact when an individual is going through that? Who are the people that can actually reach out and really help? Who should people go to?
I have to say, for the sister that called in, alhamdulillah, 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 like, her family were there to support her, and, you know, that she had that support network, because in a lot of the sisters that we speak to, they don't have that. You would have families that would persuade them to stay, families that will kind of say to them, you know, you have to think about what the community is going to say. And this is the biggest problem that we have at the moment, especially not just with domestic violence, but with sexual abuse that happens within the communities, that families are so involved with what the community has to say. What I always say, what Auntie Shabnam has to say at number 44, what she's going to think, you know, she's going to be the community gazette that's going to tell everyone, you know, X, Y, and Z without knowing. And, you know, unfortunately, families tend to be so concerned about what the community think that they tend to brush these issues under the carpet. And that is something that has to stop. The biggest thing here is having family support. And that is the biggest one, as well as surrounding yourself with like-minded individuals, people that are going to encourage you to do the best for yourself and the kids. I mean, we're talking about domestic violence, but the subject that I speak a lot more is sexual abuse. And unfortunately, in a lot of the cases, the families are not there to support them at all. Mm. And there's a lot of work that needs to be done with the community, because if you had the community support, like the sister was saying, unfortunately, and this breaks my heart, you know, that the community are still blaming her because they don't know the full story. Why are they blaming her? They're not in that situation. You know, the communities need to be educated to eradicate this issue.
Thank you.
And that's something that definitely that needs to be worked on.
Thanks. Amra boina khuira tain amra community maze manche khali family rain to boina tezodin biabangina ekuchu hoy manche খালি দোষ দিবা দোষ দেয়া হইবা আর মাতিবা এর লাগিন না নেই আর আসলে কি তো ইয়া গেছে মাঝে জানে না বা মাঝে হইবা এই তো ফুরিয়ে আসিল ফুরির বিয়া ভাঙি গেছে ফুরির কেমন কিছু দোষ আসিল না এ করছো আর এর লাগিন ও তার দায় মানছে না নেই তারা এটার কথা মাতে না ফ্যামিলি কত ফ্যামিলি আসুন ফ্যামিলি হইবা তুমি আর কিছু করিও না রা কিন্তু আল্লাহ রাহুল্লাহ যে তো এইবার হইব সেখানে তারা সরম থাকি বাস্তা চাইরা মানছে কিতা হইবা কুটুমাইন্দে কিতা হইবা বাট কুটুমাইন তে কিতা হওয়া আরও বড় নিয়ে না আপনার বাচ্চাইন তো আর কিতো ইয়াজার বিহার মাঝে কিতো ইয়াজার অকটা বড় আপনারা চিন্তা করিয়া দেখো কা আর আমরা কইরান না এক মাস আর দুই মাস ই হইলো কত কত মানুষের বইনে হয়েছেন চার বছর তিন বছর তান কষ্ট করছেন আরও বইনে হয়েছেন চার বছর সো আপনারা চিন্তা করো কথা কথা আমরা মাত্রান এক বইনে আমরা খেন থেকে ঘুরাইছেন কত মানুষে ঘুরে ইয়া তারা লাইভ মাতিতা চাইরা না তার তান কইছেন তাই তান হরিয়া তানরে অত কষ্ট দিছেন অত খালি তাইন বালা বউ নাই তাইন তাহরানা হতাহরানা কুচু ঠিক নাই কুচু ফারই না কর্তা আর হইতে 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 বউ নাই তাইন ডিপ্রেসড হয়ে গেছেন তাইন নানি বাদে ডিপ্রেশন আমাই গেছেন ওকে তান আর হাজবেন্ডরে দিয়া লাগিয়া তোমার বউয়ে হতাহরানা হতাহরানা আমি হইলাম মা আমারে নানি তুমি জেলা দেখিয়া রাখতা আমার আমার জেলা বউ সাইস্তানি লইছে না সো ওটা দিয়া জামাইয়ের ভিতরে মাথার ভিতরে হারিয়া ওটা দিলাইছেন সো আরও মাইল লাগিয়া দিছেন মাল্লা গিয়া দেয়া শেষ পর্যন্ত এবলা বহু থাইন ডিভোর্স হইয়া গেছেন কি আর কইরা আলহামদুলিল্লাহ এবলা থান নানি তোরা যান আস্তে আস্তে এবার ঠিক কর সো আপনারা আমরা যদি নানি মহিলা আপনারা থাকুন যদি আর আপনারা এলা সিচুয়েশন হয় তা কররা আপনারা প্লিজ চিন্তা করো কা এই কোন এফেক্ট করবো ওকে আমরা খোলা একজন খোলার একজন আসবেন সালাম আলাইকুম খোলা সালাম আলাইকুম Caller, can you just put the TV volume down, please? Assalamu alaikum, caller. Assalamu alaikum.
Assalamu alaikum.
Wa alaikum assalam. Brother, how would you like to get involved?
Hello.
Hello. Assalamu alaikum. Can you put the TV volume down, please?
Hello.
Okay, apne khoka.
Unda ni ve.
Joy, khoka apne TV volume khumain zen.
বাংলায় পারতাম নি
জয় বাংলায় কই দোকা
ওকে না আমি অনেক সময় ধরে আপনারা এই অনুষ্ঠান দেখলাম
জি
অনুষ্ঠান দেখলাম দেখি আসলে ইয়ো লাগে এটা খুব জিও তো আমার অভিজ্ঞতা কিছু বাইরে তো নেই আমার নিজের না আমি অভিজ্ঞতা তো নিয়ে শেয়ার করতাম সাই আর উদয় বইনে কইছেন যে তাইন খালি জামাইও তা করছেন হতা করছেন আমি দুই তিন জায়গা যেটা আমরা পাবলিক বিচার যে হইন ওটা গেছিলাম আপনার ওটার অভিজ্ঞতা শেয়ার করলাম যে দুইটা ঘটনা দুইটা ঘটনাতে আমি গেছি গিয়া পাইছি যে ওই বইন আর মা একটা ঘটনাত পাইছি যে জামাই গরো আইয়া কইছিলা যে তোমার বইনের লগে আস্তা দিন খালি ফোনও মাতো ফোনও মাতার থাকলে তুমি খালি আস্তা দিন ফোনও মাতার থাকো আমি আইলে ফোন বন্ধ করবাই ও কথা রূপে তাইন করিয়া হয়েছেন যে মা ওইলা বড় বোনের সমান আমার বোনের লোকে মাতিছি ওটা তুমি ওটা করছো ওটা লাগিয়া ডোমেস্টিক ভাইলেন্স হয়ে গেছে শেষ পর্যন্ত এটা শেষ হয়ে গেছে আর আরেকটা দেখছি আপনার গিয়া টেলিভিশন আস্তা দিন দেখেন এই বদ্র লোকে কইছে যে হরিরে গিয়া কইছেন যে আমি টেলিভিশনটা ফুকা যে তাই দেখতা না নমাজের সময়ও তাই এটা বাদ দিন না ইয়ে করি না তো এইবার আমি হজল ইয়া যাই গীতান দে গেলে গিতে গীতাইন নি কিছু ইয়ে হইন তাই উঠিয়া হয়েছেন তান হরিয়ে উঠিয়া হয়েছেন যে আল্লাহ নবীও নবুয়তি পাইছেন চল্লিশ বছর বাদে পাইছেন এর মানে হইল যে তুমি এখনো আমার ঘুরিয়ে খুব জিও বানাইলি তাই আসলে যতটা আরো কয়েকটা জিনিস আপনার আমি ঘুরাইয়া গিয়ার এই ডোমেস্টিক ভায়োলেন্সটা সূত্র আরম্ভ
হয় থ্যাংক ইউ সো দ্য কলার ওয়াজ টকিং অ্যাবাউট নাইলা বাট সামটাইমস You know, men will come and they might ask their partner or they might say, look, you know, I don't want you to do this. You know, the caller was saying his one of the examples was the sister was the wife was speaking on the phone and he came and he said, look, you know, if you get off the phone, I've come home from work. And yeah. She was very angry about that. And she was like, this is abuse. And so and then there was another case where, you know, the mother-in-law was approached. The mother-in-law was approached and was said, look, you know, it's prayer time and she's watching TV. And the mother-in-law came back with another response. So I guess, you know, we do have, you know, we spoke about the stigma attached and how men find it sometimes harder to talk about it. Doesn't mean that, you know, they're suffering in silence as well, if we want to look at it like that. So what would you say? You know, it's a very difficult one, because on the one hand, you want to say something, but if it's going to be interpreted as abuse, then it's difficult. And sometimes, you know, it can be used in the wrong way. Have you found that in your experience?
I think if you're going to approach someone, if you think something's happening in their family, then obviously you have to do it cautiously and with hikmah, with wisdom. You can't go in there all guns blazing and start accusing people of things. You should take the time to find out.
But what if it's a situation where a husband's actually saying, look, it's prayer time.
Yeah.
You need to switch off the TV.
Yeah.
And then going to the mother-in-law and saying that. And the mother-in-law's like, look, the prophet, he had 40 years to sort his character out before he started practicing, which isn't the case.
Yeah.
And so she's almost using that kind of angle. So I guess the brother is saying, look, some of us brothers out there, we're, you know, as men, we're struggling because, you know, there's a fine line. We want to support our wives, but they're taking it, they're using the abuse card on us. What do you say to, you know, someone who says that?
I'd say you can't force someone to do something, and you can ask them to do something, and they should listen to you. And they, if you have the relationship where there's mutual respect, then you'll respect each other, listen to each other, and consider each other's opinion. If a husband feels like just because he says something, the wife should follow, which she should, but she's not doing, maybe it requires further explanation and education for the wife, especially in the prayer time. Then that's something in her mind which is missing, that he needs to take the time to build up, rather than just thinking, I can state this and it will happen.
So boine khoira eblazonin boine tain namazor okhto television dekhra samaye khoira tumi off koro namazor okht arbade boine ekta manrana na hori khoira amaro furia tai aste aste thik hoibo boine khoira apnara bo zamai apnara matho ta khoro ka apnara shajjo khoro ka jela tara istamor fre knowledge gain khoren badenani taro emno automatically namazor okhto dekhta nai. Okay, so khali gya এবলা নমাজর অর্থ টেলিভিশন দেখিও না ইলা হইল হইত না আপনি আস্তে আস্তে এটা বিল্ড করা লাগব. ওকে, সো গোয়িং ব্যাক টু ইউ জুলি, ইটস গোয়িং টু কাম ব্যাক টু ইউর এক্সপিরিয়েন্সেস, সো হোয়াট এন্ডেড আপ হ্যাপেনিং টু ইউর পার্টনার আফটার ইউ, সো ইউ উড হ্যাভ গন টু দি, হোয়াট ডিড ইউ ডু?
আই লেফট এন্ড ওয়েন্ট টু আ উইমেনস রিফিউজ.
ওকে.
উইথ জাস্ট দ্য ক্লোথস অন মাই ব্যাক এন্ড মাই সনস ক্লোথস অন হিজ ব্যাক. উই লেফট এভরিথিং.
While you were pregnant as well?
While I was pregnant as well, yeah.
So what happened to your husband after that?
In fact, during the whole time, he was, I think he was sent to prison 3 times for abuse against me. And each time...
Was this during your 3 years?
Yeah, yeah. It was, I think, after maybe the first time he didn't go to prison, I can't remember, I think he just got suspended. And then each time was a 6-month sentence, but he... You know, you only do half, and because they still have access to telephones, and they come, so I was being written to and phoned,
sure,
and everything. So I was still being emotionally and psychologically abused, even though he was inside. So the final time when I finally left, he wasn't actually put in prison that time, because that time I just wanted to be free. And that what happened was, he stayed in my house because it was my house before we were married, and he wouldn't leave. He wanted me to sign over everything to him so that he wasn't homeless.
Sure.
But he didn't care that me and my children were going to be homeless. So eventually he did leave, but he emptied out my home and left me with nothing. So okay. I had to start again.
Thanks, Judy.
Yeah.
We've got an email from one of our viewers who says, really important issue that you've raised. A lot of people, men and women, think domestic violence is only physical violence. It can be emotional, blackmail, making people feel worthless. In our Bengali communities, divorce is still a taboo, and as a result, many people keep quiet for their children or what society will think. Women or men in abusive relationship need to think about the mental effects this is having on their children. I think confiding in someone close, we can help, maybe... mediate in the relationship. Children growing up with anger and frustration will grow to adults who think this emotion is normal, and worse still, okay to inflict upon others. Parents arguing is normal. Some people think you can't do that in front of children. Agree to an extent. It is important for children to also see the parents after an argument, reconcile or resolve the issue so that they as adults learn how to do this. So that's a really interesting email that the sister shares with us. Now, Layla, what I'd like you to do, because we're coming towards the end of the show, if you could tell us, you know, what can be done about it? You know, we've spoken at length, you know, tell us. So if there's someone out there who's watching this show and is going through those emotions, what can she do or he do?
Well, there's so many amazing organisations that are out there at the moment. I'm the spokesperson for a mental health charity called Inspirited Minds. And, you know, we have some amazing qualified counsellors that would listen to both. You know, it's not just for sisters, it's a service for brothers as well. And what they'll be able to do then is, you know, just speak about their issues. And the good thing is our counsellors are also have a lot of Islamic knowledge as well. And so they'll be able to give them the right and correct advice.
Culturally sensitive, yeah. Religiously sensitive.
Yeah, okay. And there's also some, you know, NOR domestic violence and First Step DV, which Sister Julie runs, is, again, other channels that brothers and sisters can approach that, you know, to get the help that they need. But also, you know, there's a community thing as well. Like us sisters, you know, we've set up, you know, like it's not even an organisation. It's just like a, you know, it's just a group of us together that are willing to offer the help and the advice and for us to talk about our experiences, to listen to them.
That's fine.
But it is that community help that they need and good friends around them.
Thank you. Naila, briefly, what would you advise people who are there? Is there anything that Layla hasn't touched upon that you would say people should be doing? What's the advice you'd give to our sisters out there?
I would definitely say speak to someone. The first step would always be to speak to someone, and you might not be ready to leave straight away, but you can start the process of healing and getting better and being away from the risk for yourself and for your children.
Sure, thank you. And Julie, you know, you've shared so much with us, and we appreciate that immensely. Tell us, you know, from someone who's a survivor, who's championed the and gone through the process, what would be your advice?
My advice isn't just to the people leaving, but it's to the people that they're going to talk to. It's to not judge and to not try to force the person to leave. And if they don't leave, that some people say, well, don't talk to me then. Don't talk to me about it. It's just to be their ears, to let them know that they're there for you. You're there for them. Because when they're ready, they will come to you if they know that you're going to listen.
Sure.
And that, yeah. So, yeah.
Thank you very much. Thank you to all our guests who have come on the show today and shared their views and obviously personal experiences from Julie. In summary, I think this is, you know, this is just the start, and, you know, the sisters, they're doing amazing work. There's so many brilliant initiatives to try and raise awareness. And the only way we're going to actually try and tackle this is if we start speaking up and we start confiding in people who we can trust. And I think don't belittle anything. Don't see it as, you know what, it will go away and I'll kind of, you know, I need to look at the bigger picture. It's not like that. If there's a problem, try and deal with it before it escalates and gets something bigger. And, you know, speak to someone to verify whether, you know, it was justifiable. Have a friend or a relative, whoever it may be, who you can kind of verify if it is actual abuse or if it is, you know, within your remit to do what you did, or whether it was justifiable for that person, the abuser, to do that. Because otherwise, if we don't talk about it, it won't work. And there's so many things that you can do as well. Please, we don't want anyone to be suffering in silence, because if you do, it will affect you emotionally, mentally, financially. It will impact your children, okay? And we all have a life, you know, and what we want to do is live that in the best way you possibly can. And obviously, from an Islamic angle, if you are going through abuse, it will affect your iman as well. It will affect you Islamically. So please, you know, do speak about it. Please don't suffer in silence. And our young brothers and sisters out there, if you see it, do help your parents. Amra alhamdulillah asko shohore ende aichi amra khotota discuss korchi apnara mind korba na khotota khoise jeta apnara ki man offensive paisen but amra ekta matha khub dorkar amra bhai boin je ekta show dekhra amra khoto boin ente khoshto khorra so amra bhai ente apnara eta khoriya ta khoin jodi apnara chinta koruka ekta right ni apnara khorra jen akun khoshto dira amra boin ente amra bhai ento rezen khorra kho akta akta amra ekpa ye khoisen apnara mani বায়ন্তর ফ্রো কষ্ট দেন কত তা হইন যেটা বায়ন্তর ফ্রো দুঃখ যায় আখতাখ আমরা কমিউনিটি মাঝে বেটাইতে মাতুইন না বা তারা ভিতরে ভিতরে কষ্ট ফাইরা প্লিজ আপনারা চিন্তা করুক আপনারা একটা করিয়া কোন দুঃখ দিরা আর আমরা হুরুতাইনতে যে গরু দেখইন আপনারা দরবার খররা আপনারা মাত কথা খররা মাররা একটা তারা ভিতরে রাখে রাখিয়া থারা রেখিলে এফেক্ট হয় থারা বড়ই আনলে থারা রেখিলে এফেক্ট হয় বক্তা আপনারা চিন্তা করুক আর আমরা হরিণ আর হরিণ আপনারা চিন্তা করিয়া দেখুক আপনারা আখতা আখতা আপনারা হরুতান্তরে যদিন আপনারা ও খতা হইন যে যেটা তার আমরা আপনার ফুয়ার ফুরের বিয়া এফেক্ট হইব রিলেশনশিপ এফেক্ট করবো আপনারা চিন্তা করিয়া দেখুক একটা রাইট নেই সো আমরা প্লিজ আপনারা ও বালা থাকুক আর ইনশাল্লাহ আপনারা নেক্সট টাইম দেখাইব আসসালামু আলাইকুম রহমতুল্লাহ বারাকাতুহ